The key to riding an Avalanche train is preparation. I'm going to show you how throughout this virtual training series. These are proven effective techniques. I'll be sharing my 24 years of instructing experience in short segments that get right to the point. There's never been a day where I have said, I'm not riding today due to the avalanche conditions. I alter my riding terrain according to the avalanche problems. Avalanches are the problem, terrain selection is the solution. Picking the right terrain takes knowledge and having options. Reckless, no. It's timing, training, and the right crew. Patience, discipline, and training pay off in avalanche terrain. By the way, that's a stock turbo at over 12,000 feet. Brad Spies is the rider. Unfortunately, we lost some great people in the sport to avalanches last winter. Many of these were survivable avalanches. This wasn't a very big avalanche, but the runout was a terrain trap which allowed the snow to pile up very deep. Limited options to escape, all three riders caught, two completely buried.
This is Mark Staples with Utah Avalanche Center. I'm about 200 feet to the side of this fatal avalanche looking at the snowpack. We didn't want to go in there because there's too much hang fire. There's too much snow above the crown face. We don't feel comfortable looking at it. If that snow avalanched, we'd be in trouble. So we're looking at the snow over here. We're getting inconsistent results. Essentially where we're seeing it break is right in here. Oh, maybe 2.5 feet down, similar in depth to the avalanche. And I think this is the interface between all the snow we've gotten since January 1st and the snow before that. About 10 days ago, we were over near Bountiful and saw this layer breaking in every single pit, consistently on all aspects. We went back, it started getting a little stronger, and even now, between here and we dug over there, we're getting inconsistent results. So, we're just saying this thin, soft, slightly weak layer, it's out there, it's lurking, I think it's gaining strength, and I don't think we're going to be seeing a lot of avalanche activity on it, but certainly this is a major red flag.
Let's move into what you can do to prepare for riding in the mountains. 4 steps that we do every day. Don't just read the danger rating, read into the forecast to get the important information. What are the avalanche problems and how are they managed? Moderate danger does not mean moderate sized avalanches. It can mean large destructive avalanches that are harder to trigger. Weather, is it contributing to the danger, adding more weight to a weak snowpack by means of snow, blowing snow, rain, rapid warming? Will the avalanche danger increase during the day due to these factors? Is low visibility not allowing you to see clues to instability or the terrain above you? Use the avalanche forecast and weather information to eliminate areas. Discuss and communicate with your group. These are the areas, the terrain, we are not going to today. Do we need to gather more information? What is our confidence in the forecast? We're going to check our airbag pack to see if the canister is full. We're going to check the leg strap. It has to be snug so the airbag pack doesn't lift off your body. We do a full radio check, and then we do a full transceiver check. Do this every time you go out. Make sure the gear you spent money on is working properly. What we're going to cover now is how to do a trailhead check. And every day we want to check our transceiver in both modes, transmit and search. We want to know that everybody in our group has the battery strength and knows how to use their transceiver in both modes. So we'll all pull out our transceivers. We're going to turn our transceivers on and everybody's going to tell what their battery strength is. We go to transmit and we relay our battery strength to the leader. If anybody needs to change out their batteries, now's the time to learn that. Then everybody in the group goes to search. We want to make sure that everybody knows how to switch their transceiver to search. Then the leader will go to transmit.
The leader goes to transmit, everybody walks away from that leader. They're going to find out the effective range of their transceiver on that day. They're actually going to drag out the signal a little farther because they're locked into it. They're going to go until they do not get a readout on the screen. Then they pull a 180 and everybody walks towards the leader and they're practicing searching with their transceiver. They're going to go towards the leader and then past the leader. Now everybody in the group has practiced searching. And that's one thing we've found at BCA is people do not practice searching enough. At that point, everybody goes to transmit. The leader is going to jump on their snowmobile or snow bike, go down the trail about 50 to 100 yards. They're going to stop, shut off the machine. They'll switch their transceiver to search. Everybody's going to go by. They're going to be about 30 yards apart. They're going not 100 miles an hour, about 30 miles an hour. And the leader will give them the okay signal when they go by. He has checked everybody now that they're transmitting.
Here's a tip of the day for you. Put an Avalanche Forecast app on your phone. I also use an app that tells me where the snow tell sites are so I can tell the snow depth and the new snowfall. Here's three apps that I use. If your group works as a team, you'll have better results in the backcountry. Too many riders are acting as individuals who ride in a group. They're not acting as a team with accountability for the other members. You should have each other's backs. Be proactive in preventing accidents. Look out for each other. Hope you enjoyed it. There's more information coming next episode. It's gonna be fast-paced with lots of information. Get your riding partners to watch. Here's some links to win prizes and learn more.